Okay, so we discussed the relationship between morita equivalence and biinterpretability, remarking that whenever you have a biinterpretability, you have morita equivalence, but very interestingly, the converse doesn't hold. So the greatest part of morita equivalences do not come from dictionaries between theories, which is very interesting. Because it means that you really need an higher point of view to unveil these connections, and that the concrete point of view will not suffice in general to identify these correspondences. In a sense, these correspondences are most of them are hidden, and Topos theory provides a most powerful way for unveiling them. Okay, so what is the relationship between morita equivalence and the classical notion of categorical equivalence between categories of set-based models of geometric theories? So suppose you have two geometric theories, T and S, such that their categories of set-based models are equivalent. Then, under which circumstances can you expect this equivalence to lift to a morita equivalence? Well, in order to have morita equivalence, you need to have for each Grothendieck topos E an equivalence between the categories of the models of the theories in E, and you also want such an equivalence to be natural, in the sense that if you have a geometric morphism between toposes, then this should induce a commutative diagram. Okay, so suppose you start with that, and so you will have functors going in one direction and the other, which are quasi inverse to each other. Now, what you have to do if you want to lift this to a morita equivalence is to try to construct these functors by only using geometric constructions. And by this, I mean constructions which involve only finite limits and arbitrary co-limits. And you will also have to take care of the fact that you don't use any non-constructive principles to build these functors. If you are able to reformulate your functors in this way, then actually they will admit a generalization to an arbitrary topos. And then, because of the fact that they can be formulated in terms of geometric constructions, all the diagrams of this form will be commutative. And so you will be able to conclude that your two theories are morita equivalent. Of course, there are situations in which such equivalences do not lift to morita equivalences. This is the case, for instance, for toposes that are non-trivial but don't have points. And so you see, when you will look at their categories of points, which are just categories of models of any theory classified by them, you will see that this category will be empty, in spite of the fact that the topos is non-trivial. And so, in general, looking just at the points of a topos will not give a faithful representation of the topos. And so, there are situations in which this lifting doesn't hold. But in the greatest majority of situations, you can indeed reformulate your equivalences in a geometric form. And if you're able to do that, then you can lift your equivalence to a morita equivalence. In fact, this technique I have applied in a couple of my papers to lift classical equivalences, in particular I have applied this in the context of equivalences for MD algebras, and I have shown that, in fact, by an appropriate reformulation of the functors defining the equivalences in geometric form, this led actually to emulate equivalence between the theories, which is a much stronger notion, which is able to provide a much stronger relationship between the theories. And so you see, once you get a Morita equivalence, you will have that the classifying topologies are equivalent, and then by using the bridge technique, you will be able to transfer a lot more information that would be possible to transfer by just having a set-based equivalence like that. Okay, so let's go on with our general presentation of the bridge philosophy. The topos-theoretic study of theories, in fact, normally theories are represented by means of sites of definition of their classifying topos, or by means of other presentation for toposes naturally attached to the classifying topos of these theories. Now, as we have already remarked, that the existence of different theories which have equivalent classifying topologies translates into the existence of different sites of definition, or more generally, different presentations for the same Grothendieck topos. And then you can use this common topos as a bridge for transferring the notions, properties, and results across these different presentations, by considering invariants defined at the topos-theoretic level from the point of view of the different presentations. So this realizes a form of unification because you see you have a unique invariant at the topos-theoretic level which will manifest itself in different ways in the context of the different presentations. So you will have a unity at the level of toposes and diversity at the level of the concrete manifestations of the invariants, and these manifestations of the invariants, as we shall see by analyzing the examples, can be quite significant. So you could get completely different, apparently unrelated properties in the context of different presentations related by the same topos-theoretic invariant. And so this technique is liable to generate a lot of deep and surprising connections between properties of different theories or different mathematical situations. Okay, so why is this methodology effective? Because in fact, in general, the relationship between a topos and its presentations is very natural, in the sense that many invariants can be understood, they can be studied, they can be naturally investigated from the points of view of the presentations for the toposes. Of course, the complexity of the calculations of different invariants in terms of different presentations will vary enormously according to the invariant. There are invariants that are notably quite difficult to calculate, in particular the cohomological invariants. There are instead invariants of toposes that are extremely easy to calculate and which can be even calculated in a mechanical way. And so really the complexity of the bridges that you can generate can vary from something very elementary to something extremely deep, depending on the equivalences you start with and the invariants you consider. Just a word about topos-theoretic invariants. In fact, the experience with topos-theoretic invariants has shown that they are actually able to capture many important features of mathematical theories and constructions. Already Grothendieck talked about the toposes as objects that could capture the essence of a certain mathematical situation. And the way this essence is captured is precisely through invariants, because it is by investigating how a given invariant expresses itself in terms of different presentations that you are able to multiply the points of view on the given problem that you want to investigate. So in fact, the key element that we have in the bridge technique is the identification of good topologies attached to the given mathematical situation and good invariants on them, which relate to the question one is interested in. If we are able to do this, then we can then investigate the given topos from different points of view by looking for different presentations of it, and this will give us different points of view on the problem that we want to investigate. And so you see that these bridges, in fact, really represent a way of multiplying the points of view on a given mathematical theme. Topos theoretic invariants actually play a central role in mathematics, even though one doesn't necessarily realize about this, because you see, given a topos, this topos has infinitely many presentations in terms of theories belonging in principle to different areas of mathematics. And so it means that because of the duality which exists between theories and topologies, everything which happens at the topos theoretic level will have ramifications in all these different contexts which can present the same topos. So here I have put a picture where I consider a simple invariant and the notion of a subtopos of a topos, and I imagine having different theories T, S, R classified by a given topos E. So we know that the subtoposes of a given topos have the structure of a lattice. And in fact, what you see from this picture is that this lattice structure, which exists at the topos theoretic level, induces lattice structures at the level of all these theories classified by the same topos, because in fact, the subtoposes of the classifying topos of a theory are, by a theorem I proved in my PhD thesis, in natural bijective correspondence with the quotients of the theory. By quotient I mean geometric theory extension in the given signature. And so you see that these theories T, S, R could in principle belong to different areas of mathematics, but the fact that they are related to each other by the same classifying topos is responsible for the fact that there are a lot of different phenomena happening in the language of, in the context of the theories, and for which the source, the responsible source, lies at the topos theoretic level. And of course, this is just a picture for a simple invariant, which is the notion of subtopos, but of course, in general, invariants will manifest themselves in significantly different ways in the context of these different theories. So you could imagine that in the context of T, you have a certain property. In the context of S, you have a completely different looking property, but still they arise as manifestations of the same topos theoretic invariant. And of course, the more complex the invariant is, the most fruitful are these connections that one can establish. Okay, so to summarize, building a bridge consists in first of all, identifying what I called the deck of the bridge, which will be an equivalence between topologies presented in different ways, or not necessarily an equivalence, but a relation of some kind between topologies presented in different ways, across which one is going to consider invariants. So, of course, in the case of an equivalence, every invariant naturally, every property naturally formulated in the language of category theory, every genuine property will be automatically invariant. So you will not have to check the invariance. In the case of a relation between the topologies which is not equivalence, then you will have to check that the invariant that you want to transfer is indeed invariant, so that you can look at it from the points of view of the different topologies. In any case, the deck of the bridge lies at the topos theoretic level. It consists in equivalences or more generally relations between topologies presented in different ways. While the arches of our bridges will be given by characterizations of the given invariant in terms of the different presentations for the given topologies. So here I have pictured just a typical bridge in which we have two sides, Cj and Dk, which give rise to equivalent topologies, and given a certain invariant I, I look at how this invariant expresses in terms of the first side. In this way, I will get a property written in the language of the first side, which I call PCJ. Of course, in general, it will not be easy to completely express the invariant just in terms of the site, but suppose that we can do it, which is the case in many situations, then we have such a property on one side. Then similarly we will get another property on the other side, written in the language of the second site, and actually we will get that the two properties will be logically equivalent to each other just because they correspond to the same topos theoretic invariant. And what is interesting about this is that these properties can be concretely completely different in spite of the fact that they arise from the same topos theoretic invariant. And I shall give very soon concrete illustrations of this. Okay, so what about invariants? Well, of course, the most classical invariants, which date back to the origins of topos theory, are the cohomological invariants, which in fact are related to the notion of geometric morphism of topologies, which of course is also an invariant. So in fact, this was the point of view that led Grothendieck to his formulation of the general framework for the study of cohomology, the so-called six operation formalism. And in fact, these cohomological invariants have had a tremendous impact on the development of algebraic geometry since Grothendieck, and of course, well beyond this subject. Another important class of invariants of topologies is given by the homotopy theoretic invariants, so the fundamental group which can be defined at the topos theoretic level, also the higher homotopy groups, etc. And the study of homotopy from a topos theoretic viewpoint also is witnessing a great development now with the theory of higher topologies. And so this is a very, very active area of current research. Still, it's important to consider that cohomological and homotopy theoretic invariants are by no means the only invariants that it is meaningful to consider on topologies. There are, in fact, many other invariants of topologies that can be equally significant and often much easier to calculate. In fact, what is nice about topologies is that since they are categories, essentially, as I have already remarked, any natural categorical property, by this I mean a genuine property written in the language of category theory, will be automatically invariant with respect to the notion of equivalence of topologies, just because this notion of equivalence of topologies is mere categorical equivalence. So this means that you can not just consider the invariants that have been already analyzed, but you can easily invent new ones. depending on the specific needs that you encounter in the analysis of the problems that interest you. In fact, even very strange, apparently strange invariants might be related to very concrete problems. So, for instance, during my PhD studies, I introduced a new invariant. It's called the demorganization of a topos. And then with my PhD supervisor, Peter Johnson, we decided to look at this invariant in the specific context of the theory of fields formalized within geometric logic. And to our surprise, we discovered that the demorganization of the theory of fields could be identified with the classifying topos of a very significant theory attached to the theory of fields, which is the theory of fields of finite characteristics, which are algebraic over their prime field. So you see, apparently there is no link between the Morgan's law on toposes and being a field of finite characteristic, which is algebraic over its prime field. But you see how the relationship between the theory of fields and that quotient of its is actually captured by a topos theoretic invariant, which apparently is not related to that question. So this illustrates the fact that it makes sense to make a very systematic investigation of topos theoretic invariants in different contexts, how they behave in the context of different presentations, in order to make these techniques more and more user-friendly and applicable by mathematicians in different fields. Because a priori it is very hard to imagine the right invariants to consider in a specific situation one wants to investigate. It's much easier to focus on building good toposes which capture essential features of the situation that one wants to explore, and then start considering several invariants on these toposes and see how they express it in terms of the presentations at hand. And all of this will generate a great number of insights around the given problem, which will, of course, greatly contribute to a global understanding of the given problem and will certainly help solving it. Okay, here I have listed just a few selected applications of the bridge technique, which have been obtained since this perspective was first introduced in 2010. So as you can see, there are applications in different mathematical fields. In fact, what I would like to stress is the fact that in each of these contexts, of course, the results are completely different, but the general methodology which is employed to derive them is always the same. So now I will proceed to discussing a few bridges established in the context of these applications. So I will start by describing how we can naturally approach Galois theory from a topos theoretic viewpoint, and how this topos theoretic viewpoint can lead us to introduce a great amount of new Galois type theories in different fields of mathematics. Then I will focus on a subject which is quite important in topos theory, the subject of theories of pre-shift type. By definition, these are the theories, the geometric theories classified by a pre-shift topos. So as you can imagine, these are sort of basic kind of theories from which every geometric theory can be obtained. So it is particularly important to understand the properties and to study them from a topos theoretic viewpoint. So I will present in particular a couple of results about them, which can be derived by using the bridge technique. In fact, theories of pre-shift type are very important because they represent the logical counterpart of small categories. So in fact, they allow you to get a logical point of view on any small category you might want to consider. And so they allow you, in particular, to prove results about small categories by using a logical point of view. In fact, this is what I did in the case of the topos theoretic interpretation of Galois theory I have mentioned, because first I proved the result using logical tools, using the setting of theories of pre-shift type, and then I was able to translate all of this into pure categorical language. So it is important to have this logical point of view, because it allows you to regard essentially any subject you want to investigate as part of logic. So this will be applied in particular to the third subject mentioned in these slides, the topos theoretic interpretation of phrase theory. I always like to present this example because it is a very beautiful example of application of the bridge technique, in which you see that the key ingredients identified by Frise in the context of his model theoretic result naturally arise from the calculation of quite elementary topos theoretic invariants in the context of different sites. And in fact, the main result from Frise gets significantly generalized, thanks to this, just by considering three invariants from two different points of view. Finally, I shall briefly discuss how stone-type dualities can be approached from the point of view of bridges. This is a sort of quite a general machinery based on toposes to generate these dualities. So one is able through it both to find again all the classical dualities, and at the same time one is able to generate many new dualities that were not discovered in many cases because of a certain complexity in the descriptions of the categories under consideration. Okay, so now let's first proceed with the first application. In the context of classical Galois theory, what we have is, given a Galois extension, we have a bijective correspondence between the intermediate finite field extensions and the open subgroups of the Galois group. Now, we can formulate this in categorical terms by expressing this as a categorical equivalence between the opposite of the category of finite intermediate field extensions and the category of continuous non-empty transitive actions of the Galois group on discrete sets. So, in fact, the content of this categorical equivalence is the same as that of the classical correspondence, because in fact open subgroups are understood from the point of view of the action of the group on the corresponding set. This is the collection of cosets with and so in this way actually you get a categorification of this classical correspondence. And in fact, the functor which goes from the left-hand side to the right-hand side is actually the functor which takes the homomorphisms to the Galois extension, from the intermediate extension K. Of course, this endowed with the canonical action of the Galois group. Okay, so this categorical interpretation leads us to raise a natural question. Can we replace our category of intermediate field extension with an arbitrary category, and can we replace our Galois extension with an object which can play an analogous role, and therefore obtain similar kind of equivalences in other fields of mathematics? Now, it turns out that it is most natural to address this question not just working at the level of sites, which is the level of these transitive non-empty actions. Remember that for any topological group G, this is a topos, and the full subcategory on the non-empty transitive actions provides a site of definition for this topos, because this is equivalent to the topos of Shiffson with respect to the atomic topology. So you see that this equivalence here actually is an equivalence holding at the level of sites. So it can be extended, in fact, to an equivalence between the natural toposes attached to these sites. So you see, on the one end, we have sheaves on the opposite of our category of finite intermediate extensions, and on the other hand, we have the full category of actions, of continuous actions of the Galois group on discrete sets. Okay, so now that we have interpreted our Galois equivalence at the topospheretic level, we are ready to look for a generalization. So what we will look for is conditions on a small category C, and on an object of the in the completion of this category, for the existence of an equivalence of toposes of the same kind as the equivalence here, formalizing Galois theory. If we are able to give such conditions, we will be able to generate many new Galois type equivalences in different fields of mathematics. So, before introducing the main result, I have to recall these notions. The amalgamation property on a category is the property asserting that any pair of arrows with common domain can be completed to a commutative square. And another property we shall need is the joint embedding property, which means that any pair of objects in the category can be mapped to a third one. Then we will have to consider conditions on the object U, which lies in the IND completion. So why do we consider the IND completion? Because in infinite Galois theory, actually the Galois extension doesn't lie in the category of finite intermediate extension. It lies in the category of all extensions, but the category of all extensions is the IND completion of the subcategory on the finite extension. So this is why I take the objects in the IND completion. Okay, so we will say that such an object is universal if every arrow in the category C admits an arrow to it. And we shall say that it is ultrahomogeneous if any two arrows from a given object to it can be transformed one into the other by a notomorphism of the given object. So you see, as in classical Galois theory, we want to have enough automorphisms on the given object to distinguish different arrows to it. Okay, so here we are. So the theorem tells us that whenever we have a small category satisfying the amalgamation and joint embedding properties, and we have an object in its in the completion which is universal and ultra homogeneous, then we have an equivalence of toposes, where in fact the automorphism group of the object is endowed with a natural topology, whose description is given here. As you can see, the definition is completely analogous to the classical definition of the topology in Galois theory. So we have such an equivalence of toposes which is induced by a functor perfectly analogous to that that we have in the classical case. So this functor sends every object of C to the set of arrows from C to U endowed with the obvious action of the automorphism group. Mm? Now, notice that this functor actually takes values in the full subcategory on the non-empty transitive actions, just because by our hypothesis the object U is both universal and ultra-homogeneous. In fact, the fact that F takes values in the non-empty actions means precisely that the object U is universal and the transitivity for the action corresponds to the property of ultra-homogeneity. Mm? So, you see, we have this functor F which actually takes values in cont T of ot U. So, it makes sense to investigate under which conditions the functor F is full and faithful, and also when it is an equivalence onto this subcategory on the non-empty transitive actions, because this will give us really the perfect analog of classical Galois theory. By using certain topos theoretic invariants, the notion of atom and the notion of arrow between atoms, we are able to identify precisely which conditions we need. So for F to be full and faithful, we need every arrow of C to be a strict monomorphism. And if we want the functor F to be moreover essentially surjective on the full subcategory on the non-empty transitive actions, we moreover need a condition on C which I have called atomic completeness. So it means essentially that every atom of this topos actually comes from the site, which is not in general the case, because what is true is that every object from the site is sent to an atom of this topos, but in general there could be atoms of this topos which do not come from the site. In particular, when you have an atom here, every quotient of this atom will still be there, and there is no guarantee that it will come from the base category. So you need a certain condition on the category, which I have called atomic completeness, and which can be characterized explicitly for this to hold. Mm? And so this is quite interesting if you think about it, because it shows that in fact there are quite mild conditions for having an equivalence at the topos theoretic level, and much stronger conditions for this equivalence to restrict to an equivalence of size. And so this shows that you gain much more flexibility by investigating things at the level of toposes than you would by remaining at the concrete level of size. So of course this theory generalizes Grothendieck's theory of Galois categories, which corresponds to considering just profinite automorphism groups, and it can be applied to generate many other Galois-type theories in different fields of mathematics, for which the automorphism groups are not pro-discrete, but can be interesting anyway. For instance, one gets a Galois theory for finite groups, a Galois theory for finite graphs, for finite Boolean algebras, etc. So all these examples do not fit in Grothendieck's original framework. In fact, Grothendieck, with his theory of Galois categories, instead of working at two levels, the level of sites, in our case, the atomic sites and the level of toposes, he worked at just one level, the level of pre-toposes. And so this didn't give him enough flexibility for capturing phenomena such as those which concern the setting of non-profinite topological groups. In fact, in the context of non-profinite topological groups, there are interesting phenomena that of Morita equivalence which occur. For instance, we have the very elementary but non-trivial example of the Shanoel topos. Which is the topos of sheaves on the opposite of the category I of finite sets and injections with respect to the atomic topology. Now, you can realize that for any S infinite set, actually this set is a universal ultra-homogeneous object in the sense of our definition, and so we can represent our topos as the topos of continuous actions on the automorphism group of, well, it is simply the group of bijections of S, topologized with the topology of pointwise convergence. And so this holds for any infinite set. So in particular, you could have infinite sets of completely different cardinality that will give rise to equivalent toposes, in spite of the fact that you don't have isomorphism. You don't necessarily have isomorphism between these two topological groups. So you see that, in fact, at the level of topological groups, the relationship of Morita equivalence, saying that these groups give rise to equivalent toposes, is by no means trivial. You see, this very elementary example also shows that really you have to adopt the point of view of toposes if you want to relate to things such as S and S prime, which are not directly related from a concrete viewpoint. So this theorem also shows that there could be situations in which your functor F is full and faithful, but is not an equivalence. And so in such a situation, you might wonder what you have to add to the original category in order to get a category equivalent to the category of non-empty transitive actions on the other side. And in fact, the investigation of the invariant notion of atom of such topos from the point of view of the atomic site leads to a notion of imaginary, a categorical notion of imaginary. Imaginary is here, this is the model theoretic terminology. In fact, it really corresponds to imaginaries in the model theoretic sense because they are definable quotients of the given object. But anyway, using this topos theoretic viewpoint, we are able to categorically describe in a very concrete and explicit ways the objects that we have to add to C in order for it to be to become equivalent to the category on the other side. of course, under the hypothesis that the functor f should be full intact. And so you see, all of these results would be hardly attainable using a point of view different from the one provided by Topuzis. So it is certainly a quite compelling illustration of the indispensability of Topuzis in this context. Okay, so now let's turn to the second theme I already introduced, that of theories of pre-shift type. So these theories are quite important because, as I anticipated, they constitute, in a sense, the basic building blocks from which every geometric theory can be built. In fact, as I already stated, every Grothendieck topos is a subtopos of a pre-shift topos, and so from a logical viewpoint it is natural to regard a geometric theory as a quotient of a theory of a pre-shift type. Let me recall that by quotient I mean a geometric theory extension in the same signature. Now, theories of pre-shift type, as I already mentioned, are important because they constitute, in a sense, the logical counterpart of the small categories. In the sense that when we have a theory of pre-shift type, then its category of set-based models is equivalent to the indecompletion of its full subcategory on the finitely presentable ones. So by finitely presentable, I mean that the covariant home functor preserves filtered colimits. So this is quite easy to see that we can represent the category of its set-based models as the indecompletion of the finitely presentable ones. But what is most interesting is the converse statement. So suppose you have a small category C, then you consider its indecompletion. And then what is nice is that you can recover not quite C, but its Cauchy completion from this category by taking the finitely presentable objects there. And so you see that, in fact, talking about small categories is more or less the same as talking about their idempotent splitting completions, and so it is the same thing as talking about the categories of finitely presentable models of a theory of pre-shift type. And so you see, this is quite appealing because it means that for whatever category as concrete as it can be, if this is a small category, it can be natural to regard every object of this category as a finitely presentable model for a certain theory of pre-shift type, which will be canonically the theory of flat functors on the opposite of it, because the indecompletion is equivalent to the category of flat functors. And so, every geometric theory can actually be expanded to a theory classified by a pre-shift topos. In fact, theories of pre-shift type are very rich in terms of the syntax. And so you can, by appropriately enriching the syntax and the proof theory of your theory, to get to a theory classified by the corresponding pre-shift topos. So all of this is described in my book. Okay, so examples of theories of pre-shift type. We have, of course, all finite array algebraic theories and more generally all Cartesian theories inside this class. But very interestingly, this class also contains many other mathematical theories whose syntactic presentation differs significantly. Here I have put a list, by no means exhaustive, just to illustrate the variety of theories belonging to this class. Now, what is interesting from our point of view is the point of view of toposes as bridges is the fact that whenever we have a theory T of pre-shift type, this theory gives rise to two different representations of its classifying the topos. One of semantic nature, the topos of functors from the category of finitely presentable models of the theory in two sets, and on the other side, the classical syntactic representation of the classifying topos as sheets on the syntactic side. Now, this is interesting because you see, you get a topos represented in two different ways, and one side represents the semantics, the other side represents the syntax. And so we can expect many relationships between the syntax and semantics to be unveiled by the bridge technique applied in the context of such an equivalence. This is indeed the case, for instance, by considering the invariant notion of irreducible object from the point of view of the two sides. We get on the one hand all the finitely presentable models, and on the other hand the formulas in the syntactic category of the theory, which are irreducible with respect to the syntactic topology. So in the sense of this definition. So actually from this bridge we get a theorem which gives us an equivalence between the opposite of the category of finitely presentable models of the theory and the category of irreducible formulas. So it is a full subcategory on the syntactic category on the formulas which are irreducible in the sense of that definition. So in fact this allows us to understand which are the formulas which present the models of the theory of pre-shift type. And so to understand which kind of geometric formula can present a model and conversely. So you see how this bridge immediately leads us to that result. And you see also that this notion of irreducibility is really quite natural from a topos theoretic viewpoint, but not necessarily very natural as a concrete condition. So you really see that it is a notion which you get by expressing a topos theoretic invariance in terms of a certain presentation, such as the syntactic site in this context. Another example of an insight that you can get by using bridges is a definability result for this class of theories. So here the invariant you consider is the notion of subobject of the universal model of the theory, which you can describe both in terms of the first representation and in terms of the second. I cannot go into the details of that. You can find it, for instance, in my book, if you want to read all the details. But you can see from this bridge that this invariant expresses itself as a functorial assignment on the on the left-hand side, and as a geometric formula in a given context on the right hand side. And so by putting together these two concrete expressions of the same invariant, you get this theorem, which says that any property of tuples of elements of finitely presentable models of the theory, which is functorial in the sense that it is preserved by arbitrary model homomorphisms, is definable by a geometric formula over the signature of the theory. So this is a theorem which we not hold in general for all geometric theories, but it holds for theories of pre-shift type, and the true reason why it holds is actually this bridge. Okay, so now that we have talked about the theories of pre-shift type, we can formulate our topos-theoretic interpretation of Frese's theory. First we need to introduce this notion, which in fact is by no means arbitrary. We shall see in a moment that it arises just from the expression of a certain topospheretic invariant in terms of a site. So it is this notion of homogeneity for a model of a theory of pre-shift type. So it is this form of injectivity with respect to arrows between finitely presentable models of the theory. And this is the theorem that we will get, which represents a significant generalization of Frese's classical theory. So the theorem says if you have a theory of pre-shift type whose category of finitely presentable models is non-empty and has the amalgamation and joint embedding properties, then the theory T prime axiomatizing the homogeneous T models is complete and atomic. So here is how one gets this theorem. So you see that there are three bridges, one for each invariant that we decide to consider. So we consider first the invariant property of a topos to be atomic. And we see that this is related to the fact that the site we consider here on the left-hand side is atomic. But on the other hand, it amounts precisely to the theory T prime classified by this topos, the quotient of T classified by this topos, to be atomic in the sense of model theory. So already you see a connection between the amalgamation property on this category and the syntactic property of atomicity of the theory. So apparently these two properties are completely unrelated, but in fact you see that they just come from the expression of the unique topospheretic invariant. Then we consider another quite elementary invariant, the notion of a topos being two-valued. So two-valued means that the only subterminal objects are 0 and 1, and they are distant from each other. So if you look at this invariant from the two sides, you get the joint embedding property on the category of finitely presentable models of the theory. And on the other hand, very interestingly, you get the property of completeness of the theory T prime. So recall that first order theory is said to be complete if every first order assertion written in its language is either provably true or provably false, but not both. And so you see how a very complex property of first order theory turns out to be equivalent in this situation to a very simple property on the other side. Just because both properties correspond to the same topospheretic invariant. Finally, we consider another very simple invariant of toposes in the context of the same equivalence. So look at this. So the deck of the bridges is always the same. What changes is just the invariance I consider on them. So here I take the notion of point, and by calculating this in the context of the first site here, the atomic site, we get precisely the notion of homogeneous T-model, which I gave in the previous slide. While on the other side, of course, I get the notion of T-prime model just by definition of the classifying topos of T-prime. And so you see immediately how from this triple bridge we get the theorem written there. Okay, as a last example that I would like to present in this course, there is the theory of stone-type dualities approached through topos-theoretic bridges. In fact, the idea behind the interpretation of these stone-type dualities, which are dualities between special kind of pre-ordered structures and other pre-ordered structures or locales or topological spaces, is that the two objects which correspond to each other under such a duality or an equivalence should be related to each other by means of a topos attached to one and to the other independently from each other. So the setting is this, is that of equivalences of this kind between two toposes, so a topos of sheaves on a certain pre-order category D with respect to a certain Grothendieck topology K of D, and C to be a dense subcategory of D. So that by Grothendieck's comparison lemma, we have an equivalence between the two categories of sheaves, the sheaves on the big side and the sheaves on the smaller dense subsite, where this topology will be induced by this topology on the subcategory. So by dense subcategory, I mean a subcategory such that you can cover every object in the bigger category with respect to the event topology by objects lying in the subcategory. So a simple example of dense subcategory is when you have a basis for a topological space, because in such a situation, you can of course regard B as a full subcategory of the category of open sets of the space. And if you put here the canonical topology, you realize that the condition for B to be a basis amounts precisely to saying that this subcategory should be dense with respect to this topology. Okay, so basically we start from equivalences of this kind, and then we will factorialize these equivalences to generate our dualities or equivalences. So, in fact, this machinery lies on the following key points. First of all, we given a pre-order that we want to relate to something else on the other side, we try to define a natural Grothendieck topology on it, which in some way exploits the lattice theoretic structure present on it. So, for instance, in the case of the classical stone duality, if we have B Boolean algebra, what is natural to do is to put on this algebra, regarded as a pre-order category, a Grothendieck topology which exploits the lattice theoretic structure present on it. So we take the coherent topology on it, whose covering C's are those which contain finite covering families. Covering families in the sense that B is the join of this family in the Boolean algebra. So we put that, and then we consider this topos as a topos which, in a sense, capture the essence of the Boolean algebra. And in fact, what we will see is that this is equivalent precisely to the topos of Schiff on the associated Stone space. Stone space of B. So notice that you have such a bridge for each pair of objects related by the duality. So if you actually wanted to get the duality, you will have to functorialize this bridge, so to understand what happens when I make my Boolean algebra vary. So you see, if I consider a homomorphism of Boolean algebras, what do I have at the level of the topos? Well, I have, so this of course gives a morphism of the coherent sides, so a geometric morphism going in this direction, and then this of course transfers to a geometric morphism here, and since these spaces are sober, well, it means that this will come from a unique continuous map between the Stone spaces. And so you see how I get Stone duality out of the bridge technique. So the process is completely general. So you see the way we get these dualities is by factorializing the assignments of the topos associated with the structures by means of either morphisms or comorphisms of the sides, as we introduced them yesterday. And then, of course, a key point in this theory is the possibility of entering and exiting the bridge on both sides. Because, you see, at the end, the topos disappear. They are just instrumental for relating the two objects with each other. So it is important to be able to enter a bridge, but also exit it. So in particular, one needs to be able to get the structures back from the topos associated with them. And in fact, what is appealing is the fact that if the topologies that you put on your preorder structures are, defined in a sufficiently natural way, then you can recover indeed these structures from the corresponding topos through a notion of generalized compactness, as it is written here. So here I have given the example of Stone duality, but it works exactly in the same way for all the other dualities in the same class, which historically have been discovered quite independently from each other. For instance, another important duality is Lindenbaum-Tarski duality between sets and complete atomic Boolean algebras. So this duality sends a Boolean algebra of this kind to its set of atoms, and conversely, it sends an arbitrary set to the Boolean algebra given by its power set. And theoretically, what is going on is that shifts on B with respect to the canonical topology is equivalent to the topos of three shifts on the set of atoms regarded as a discrete category. And conversely, we have that for any set S, again, regarded as a discrete category, we get an equivalence like this. And you see, in this situation, if you want to get the Lindemann-Tarski duality, you have to factorialize not by using the morphisms of sides, but by using comorphisms of sides. Mm? And this explains why on the side of Boolean algebras, you have to take the morphisms to be complete. The homomorphisms between these Boolean algebras in order to correspond to functions between the sets of atoms must preserve not only arbitrary joints but also arbitrary knits. And this you see very naturally by adopting this point of view of geometric morphisms induced by comorphisms of sides. Sides which in this case are trivial because we have this toposis. Okay, now I would like to conclude with a few general remarks about this bridge technique. So as you have by now understood, the key point in all of this is the essential ambiguity given by the fact that a topos is associated in general with an infinite number of different presentations, be them theories or sites or good points or whatever. But the fundamental point is the fact that we have two levels, the level of toposes, where invariants naturally live, and the level of different presentations for them, which can belong to different areas of mathematics. And it is precisely this duality which we exploit for generating our insights. So what is going on here is a sort of mathematical morphogenesis, because given any fixed invariant that we decided to consider, what we do is to investigate how this invariant expresses in terms of different presentations for toposes. And so it is precisely this morphogenesis of generation of diversity from a unity which lies at the topos theoretic level, which allows us to contemplate all these connections existing between properties and notions that apparently could be completely unrelated to each other. So you see, the bridge technique suggests a radically different way of doing mathematics, which is really guided by toposes, guided more precisely by Morita equivalences between different presentations and topos theoretic invariants considered on the toposes attached to these presentations. So it is really by letting ourselves guided by these concepts that we uncover all these hidden connections and that we are able to extract concrete informations on the mathematical situations that we want to investigate. So there is another very important aspect of this duality which deserves to be mentioned, which is the idea of completion. So when we build the classifying topos of a theory, from its syntactic site, so what is going on is really a completion process. So here you have just the geometric formulas written in the language of the theory. While when you pass to the classifying topos, you add much more. Actually, you add all the concepts that can be geometrically expressed in terms of the language of the theory, but expressed in a much richer sense, because here you just take the geometric formulas. Here, what you do by passing from this category to this topos is to add arbitrary coproducts and arbitrary quotients by internal equivalence relations. Therefore, here you can express much more than you can here. So you see, this passage can be seen as a completion with respect to all the concepts that are implicit in the theory, but not explicitly present here. And so we can think of this as a materialization of the potential hidden in the theory or the given site. And so this is quite interesting because you see when you pass from the world of theories to the world of toposes, by assigning to each theory its classifying topos, actually you go from a very unstructured world, the world of theories. Why do I say unstructured? Well, because a theory by itself is not a structured entity. It is just a collection of axioms in a given formal language. So, in particular, you can easily make modifications to a given theory to introduce new theories. You can perform a lot of very natural operations here without having to worry that the result will still be a theory. Because essentially, you see, you have no structure here. While here, you go to a maximally structured environment, full of symmetries. You see, symmetries and invariants are the same. So we know that invariants naturally live here. And so, as you can imagine, this duality between this relatively unstructured world of theories and this maximally structured world of toposes is very rich and interesting. Because on the one hand, you can profit from the lack of structure present on the theory side in order to make all sorts of modifications without having to worry about things being well defined, because here it's still a very, very big world. And then you automatically will have toposes attached to these modified theories, which will incarnate their meaning. And then you, when you want to make computations, you will make them at the toposphoretic level, because here you can benefit from this very rich categorical structure that you have on a topos, and which allows you essentially to calculate what you want without having to worry about going out of the mathematical environment where you are. And so, actually, what here is at play is a sort of duality which we can think of as a duality between real and imaginary, in the sense that you see when you pass from a site to the corresponding topos, you can think that a site is something real or tangible in a sense, because you regard this as very concrete. So this is the context where you work as a mathematician. You are interested in understanding certain concrete properties of sites or theories. And this instead is a much more abstract setting, which you have obtained from the original setting by adding all these imaginaries, all these quotients of co-products of things coming from the site by definable equivalence relations. So these are really imaginaries in the sense of model theory. And still, you have a very nice duality between the two levels because, as we have stated several times, invariants defined at the toposphoretic level can be very profitably and very often well understood from the point of view of the sites generating the toposes. And so you see that in a sense for going from a real thing to another real thing, so like from a given site to another site, and to transport information about them, you have to do this jump into the imaginary world of toposes and then come back as it is summarized in this picture. Ok, Okay, so here I have listed just a key features of toposis which account for the effectiveness of this bridge technique. Of course, the idea of bridge goes much beyond topos theory, but there are reasons why it becomes very effective when implemented in the context of toposis and their presentations. And this is a list of reasons, of main reasons for which this is the case, at least in my view. So this is just a collection of meta-mathematical considerations about the generality of topos theoretic invariants, their expressivity. In fact, it's quite important for mathematicians to realize that many of the invariants that they are naturally led to consider could be lifted to topos theoretic invariants. And it would be quite quite useful for them to think in these terms. So because suppose they want to calculate a certain invariant attached to a concrete object they have. If they are able to build a topos attached to this object and to lift this invariant to a topos theoretic invariant considered on that topos, well, this will open the way for completely different calculations of the same invariant arising from different representations for the same topos. And so the mathematician will then benefit from this multiplication of points of view that topos theory allows. And so in general, it is quite fruitful to look for toposes which capture the essence of the mathematical situations where one is, and in particular to try to lift invariants that one is led to consider at this topos theoretic level. Okay, so a remark which has been made about this methodology by André Joyal is that all of this can be seen as an extension of Klein's Erlangen program, which is a program of understanding geometries through their associated automorphism groups. So earlier in the course we have seen that toposes actually generalize discrete groups through the categories of actions on these groups. And so actually if we think at what Klein used to do, so he used to classify geometries by means of their automorphisms groups, and in fact by doing this he discovered surprising connections between different looking geometries through the study of the algebraic properties of these automorphism groups. So of course here we replace groups by toposes, and so you can understand that still, I mean, the philosophy is the same. We are studying instead of algebraic properties of the automorphism groups, more generally invariants of these classifying toposes, or more generally toposes attached to the given situations. And so, of course, as we have already seen, all of this leads to the discovery of many non-trivial deep connections between different mathematical contexts. So, future directions, of course, there are many because this approach still is quite recent, and so in my opinion, we are at the very, very beginning of explorations going in this direction. So hopefully there will be more and more people who will try to apply this kind of techniques in their fields of interest. What is sure is that the experience accumulated so far leaves no doubt to the fact that toposes really have an authentic creative power in mathematics. because their study, the study of their invariants, naturally leads to the discovery of a great number of notions, natural results, good notions, because you see, when a notion is got through a topospheric invariant, in some sense you have a guarantee that it is a good notion, because it will be a modular notion, a notion which will admit automatically infinitely many variants equivalent to it, but pertaining to other mathematical contexts. So you see, you have the guarantee that it is not a marginal notion. It is a notion that you will be able to approach from a great variety of different perspectives. So you see how toposes are useful also for telling you whether certain notions you consider are good or maybe a bit marginal and then could be replaced by other notions that satisfy this modularity properties. So you see, it gives really an awareness in exploring mathematics that, in my opinion, is unprecedented, because the generality of the notion of topos makes it possible to apply this in essentially any situation. So what we plan to do is, of course, to make this theory more and more user-friendly in the next years, so that more people who don't necessarily have a full expertise on toposes will still be able to profit from these techniques in their fields of interest. So here I have listed a few central themes in this unification program that we aim to further develop. So as you can see, there are different subjects that really wait for a toposphere treatment. In particular, in algebraic geometry, number theory, there are many important dualities and correspondences that would be quite interesting to investigate from a toposphere viewpoint. Then, of course, it is important to continue the systematic study of topospheric invariants in terms of their presentations. In general, when you compute an invariant in terms of a presentation, it is technically feasible in many cases, but the result can be still quite surprising. And so it's important to get more and more used to this duality between invariants and their expressions in terms of different presentations, in order, of course, to make all these techniques more and more applicable in concrete situations. Then, of course, one main theme that will be important to address is the factorialization of model theory. So, I mean, there are many results, both in classical and in modern model theory, that still wait for a topospheric treatment. In fact, the interpretation of Frese's result, which I presented in the course, is an illustration of the kind of insight that you can get by looking at a piece of classical model theory using the topospheric lenses. Of course, there is a lot to gain. Remember that we got a wider generalization of Frese theorem just by looking at three invariants in the context of that equivalence. But you see, why three? I could have considered infinitely many invariants, and by doing this, I would have gotten other results on the same theme, but in general independent from each other. In fact, the paper which describes all of that contains other results in the same theme, obtained by the consideration of other invariants. So you see how this is powerful. By considering three invariants, you already get a much better version of the classical theorem. Then, of course, you can consider, there is no reason to limit oneself to consider those three. You can consider others, and so you see how this opens the way for many developments. So, of course, it would be important to do this for any result, both in classical and modern model theory. In particular, it would be important to get a topospheretic approach to stability theory, which is one of the most sophisticated developments in model theory. And then, of course, there are many other subjects that are important to develop. In particular, it's quite important to develop techniques for reasoning over an arbitrary base topos. So it's important to develop a good and user-friendly relative theory of classifying toposes over an arbitrary base topos. So identify a good relative geometric logic, etc., and understand how natural two categorical operations on toposes can be understood from the point of view of logic and of the theories classified by these toposes. And then, of course, it's also important to extend the bridge technique to the setting of higher categories, higher sites, and higher toposes to understand what is the analog of geometric logic in the higher setting, which is not yet done. And then to understand in general how toposes can shed light on the construction of spectra for different kinds of structures. There are a number of authors that have worked on that, but still we are missing a completely unified and most general treatment subsuming all these results. Okay, so concerning references, so for the basic part of the course where I gave the preliminaries, I suggested the excellent book by MacLean and Mordyke, Shifts in Geometry and Logic, so you will be able to find all the classical results which I mentioned in the course. And then concerning the more recent perspective of toposes as bridges, I suggest first having a look at my habilitation thesis, which is a 100 pages text written specifically for non-specialists, while my book is more sophisticated, and so it is better to have it as a second reading. If after reading the habilitation thesis you are still committed to deepen your understanding. Okay, so I'll stop here and I thank you very much for your attention.